touch our lips and speak with them, and touch our hearts and set them on fire with love for thee. Amen. It's been truly an abundant blessing to spend these 2 days with you. You welcomed me as a friend and presumed that this Episcopal bishop raised in the hills of Tennessee and transplanted to Southern California might be able to provide you some use in your work, and at least you fooled me into thinking maybe I have. And the joy of these sorts of occasions is that I just pray I give as good as I get, because I have lots of wonderful things to tell when I go back home to my friends and loved ones about you, about you as a church. I continue to wonder why your dear bishop chose me to come and be with you. I figured he wanted another bishop that had some sort of accent. We could go through the rest of the morning and do all sorts of different ways to express things like that dog don't hunt. The Scottish Jesus. What I've come to mostly appreciate in these last 2 days is how similar our context for ministry is. We know that the Constantinian church has gone. It is in the past. And we look around and we see a world that continues to be in travail. Sort of same story, different chapters. A bubble panic. What happened this week with the death of 2 soldiers in Canada? What happened in New York City with those police officers? Friday in Seattle. Great harm and seeming hate. Ingredients of a worldwide recipe of fear and suspicion. The simple truth is this: God's creative masterpiece, this world we inhabit, this fragile earth, our island home, and this global family, continues to need God's reconciling love. Our call as the body of Christ is to respond in new and fresh ways. Renew, reimagine, re-again. Indeed, God's church is in the midst of a season of renewal and reimagining, so that God's church, this church, can be the church of God's reconciling love today and tomorrow. Your vision casting leading up to this synod, and what you have been doing and have done in these 2 days, is that task of reimagining and renewal. It's all about the church's mission. It's all about the church's mission being God's mission. And it's in this moment, in this context, that our election brings Jesus to us on the eve of the greatest intersection of his power and the powers and principalities of that world. He's entered Jerusalem. The shadow of the cross is dominant. He's being tested. The religious authorities are desperate in their efforts to discredit him, and he cuts a fine line between being an Orthodox Jew and yet offering something new, mystical, something of grace. Remember the prayer of Good Friday that I used yesterday. Things which are cast down are being raised up. Teacher, which commandment of the law is the greatest? Now, many of us know that the Pharisees were good at counting up the laws, and they figured out that there were 613 distinct commandments, of which 248 were positive precepts, good deeds that one does, and 360 65 prohibitions. Common to the discussion of the lightness or heaviness of a particular commandment. And in this gospel, Jesus is asked, which is the heaviest? This Jesus that we follow is in the crosshairs of an enemy that would nail him to the cross for bashing their law. Their law, not God's. But Jesus faithfully, this is what we pray to share the heart of God, God's dream, God's vision. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And that's not particularly remarkable. He's not stepped out too far. It's the Shema. What all pious Jews daily recite. But then what's next? He offers more. Drawing from Leviticus, he says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And then he claims extraordinary power to speak as the voice of God on these two commandments, and all the law and the prophets. This so-called summary of the law is remarkably consonant with the answer of Rabbi Hillel gave when teaching on the whole of the Torah, which is despicable to you, do not do to your fellow. This is the whole Torah. The rest is commentary. Jesus does not give the summaries of your rabbi, does he? He is the Son of God. He is our Lord. This is what we are to do. Love God first, but recklessly keep going, loving our neighbors as ourselves. And oh, by the way, loving ourselves. Again, remember when he is saying this, he is walking to the cross. On to Golgotha. Here he will demonstrate first love of God by giving himself to God. As Paul, using that Philippian hymn, the kenosis hymn, says, emptying himself, obedient to the point of death, even death upon the cross. This is the Jesus who can then say on that cross, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. All of this is to underscore his own authority in summarizing the law and teaching us our true humanity. What that spark of the divine being created in the Imago Dei actually means. It's all about love. It's all about complete love. Not sippy sort of surface love, agape, crossing love, sacrificial love. Going to a deeper level. Going to that place where he can even claim to be above David, to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, so that as such he can teach us to be empty and to be wholly filled. Love. That's who we follow. Now, yesterday, Bishop Logan suggested to you that you were at a point of a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Indeed. I found myself thinking back to an experience I had a few years ago when, in San Diego, we were trying to save our Episcopal community service on the point of bankruptcy. And I actually asked a bankruptcy lawyer to come and be with our board engaged in knowing bankruptcy lawyers at that time, and I haven't since. I made it through that horribly difficult, challenging time to a place of grace, health, and wholeness. And a few years later, I ran into that attorney at a Christmas party, and he asked, "How's it going?" I was so grateful and relieved to say, "It's going great." And he said, "Well, you know, a crisis is a terrible thing to waste." And I thought back about how freeing that time was. And to the extent. And so he walked up to the chapter house and called for them to come in peace and to be reconciled. Not surprisingly, there was no response. What happened next has gone down in Irish history. It's a holy moment. With his sword, he gorged a hole in the wood of the great door of the chapter house. On the other side, remember, there were men with their swords. And he thrust his hand through the hole in the door. And his hand was grasped. A miracle of love and reconciliation by the Earl of Ormond. They shook hands. The door was opened, and the feud was over. So here's the real deal, dear ones. We are called to open doors to be sure. Sometimes to forge apertures through those doors and extend our hands to places where they might just be cut off. It's a moment of risk. It's an opportunity. It's a terrible thing to waste that opportunity because that is what God has called us into being in this moment of time and in this precious place, to be vulnerable. And Frederick Buechner, I want you all to know, you have an Episcopal bishop about to quote a Presbyterian. All will be well. Frederick Buechner once was asked in an interview to summarize the Bible, and he said this. I think it can be done in these three sentences. God created the world. The world became a damn mess. God did not give up on the world. God is counting us not to give up on each other, on God and God's mission. And God is calling us to take this opportunity of reconciling love and extend ourselves, our souls, and bodies in that mission.